I'm Lance Lambert. Thanks for tuning in to the Vintage Vehicle Show. We are in beautiful downtown Burbank at the Autobooks Bookstore. This is an incredible collection of automotive books. I've never seen a collection this large, all available for sale, a wonderful place. There's also a car show here every Saturday morning, and that's what we're going to cover. You're going to see some great cars, meet some great people, listen to some great music. So do what I tell you to do every week. Just kick back, relax, and enjoy the show. Anybody that's watched the Vintage Vehicle Show knows I have a soft spot for unusual cars, especially orphan cars. Well, we have a 1927 Nash here. You don't see that very often. Kind of a traditional hot rod style. Chris Casney, tell me about your 1927 Nash.
Well, my 1927 Nash was basically, I found a part, the cowl, at the swap meet in Pomona and decided to make a car out of it.
So everything, this is a swap meet put together, spend years finding the parts kind of project?
I spent 9 months building a car on the cheap, low budget, trying to do something that's unusual and that I can use to drive daily from Hollywood to Burbank. It's my daily driver too.
A couple of things really stand out on this car as unusual. Your grill and the tail end of the car. They don't look 27 Nash to me.
The grill is a 1920s, I was told, international tractor grill. And the rear section of the car is actually a 1952 Ford truck hood. And everything else I've made.
So the truck hood, the shape of it, explains the boat tail on the back.
That's exactly. As people told me, okay, this looks like a boat tail, blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, okay, let's call it the boat tail, you know.
It is a boat tail now. And the power plant on this?
Ford 302 motor, mid-70s. Not as traditional as the purists don't like it too much, but this is not a traditional car.
I don't think you have too many 1927 Nash purists running around.
I don't think I've ever seen a 1927 Nash before or know anybody who has.
A car like this with that motor, what do you have, about 1,500 pounds, 2,000 pounds a car here?
I don't know. It's really light. I mean, it moves.
So 302 is totally adequate.
That thing just like blows everybody out of the water. And I get 25 miles a gallon out of it too, so I got it all.
It's almost green.
It's my little hybrid here.
The hobby has changed in the last 10 years or so, where cars, I've never seen a car that looks just like this, but lots of similar cars,
right.
The old traditional trend in the hobby, or the rat rod, if you want to call it that, mm-hmm. has been, I think, a really positive influence on the hobby. To me, it tells people just relax and enjoy yourself. Build
That's
something
exactly
that doesn't.
Right.
What's your feeling on that? And did you start out lusting after 57 Chevs that were trailer queens and ended
absolutely
up here?
Absolutely not. That's absolutely not what it's all about. I think what has come down to the last 10 years is like people are starting to build their own cars again. And 10 years ago, it was like, or from what, when I went to car shows 10, 15 years ago, it was like people would show up with these high-dollar cars that they had no part in building, and now all the young guys, first of all, can't afford these cars, and now they want to build their own thing with their own hands and take pride in that, because that's what it's all about in hot rodding, making your own thing.
What do you think about people that take a brand new fiberglass 32 Ford body and all brand new parts and add the patina, add the dirt, add the age, and make it look like it's an old beat up hot rod? What's your feeling?
Well, I've seen many of those that look all right, but the car doesn't have soul.
Yeah, that's
if you want a fiberglass car, that's fine. And the 32, you can't afford a steel body. Original steel body is out of the question. I don't know. It's not for me. Fiberglass is not my thing.
This particular one, you added the back end, the boat tail with the truck hood, and you dropped in some new sides on it. How many pieces are there? I mean, do you have the front cowl, you have the back end, and then you have four other pieces or 100 other pieces?
Well, what I had to do is basically shape what wasn't there. I had very minimal parts. I had the hood I used for the rear, the cowl. I actually made doors for this. I had originally had two doors I made, and then my wife I saw my wife one time at my shop climbing over the doors and over the side of it. And I'm like, okay, I guess we don't need doors, so welded them shut. There's a couple other parts, small, like the rear sections are sheet metal, but other than that, I mean, there's not much to it.
And the final touch, this may have to do with your trade, your windshield posts or handsome pieces of wood. How'd that come about?
Thank you. Yeah, no, I'm a furniture maker by trade, so I was trying to find a nice aluminum Duval style windshield frame. Couldn't find anything that would fit or looked right to me or I could afford, for that matter. So I was like, okay, screw this, I'm making my own. And I spent like 2 days shaping these pieces, and there we go. Custom windshield frame.
Yeah. Well, Chris, it was a good choice. It's a beautiful car. Congratulations on really building your own car and not spending the family fortune on it. And thank you for being on the Vintage Vehicle
Show. Thank you so much.
Here's something different for you. I am in a 1924 Buick boat tail Speedster. First time I've ever even seen one. Maybe the first time, Paul Rogers, I've ever heard of one. Yeah. How did this come into your life?
Well, I just overheard a conversation, a guy talking about how he had the car sitting behind his shop and wanted to get rid of it before it just sat there for so long it was going to rot away. And I jumped on that opportunity.
Of course, the whole world knows of lots of boat tail cars. Ford made lots of Speedsters, or people made Speedsters out of Fords. How frequently was this done to Buicks? I don't recall ever seeing one.
Not too frequently. You know, it was like whoever, you know, the person who had the car decided to do that. And, you know, because most of them were, you know, the original factory boat tails were like Auburns and the high-end cars. And this was just a project that somebody decided to take on.
I noticed your boat tail is actually made out of canvas.
Yes.
Yeah. With a zipper down the middle.
Well, that's how they used to do them. You know, originally they used to do fabric for the tail sections.
Keep them light and aerodynamic?
Yeah. Plus, it's also cheaper.
Mm-hmm. What's power per amp? What makes this thing go?
It's a 274 cubic inch in-head valve Buick.
And you mentioned off camera that we are sitting in a car that has the same tires on it that were on it 70 years ago. Is that what you said?
Yeah, they're 19 from the 30s.
The actual tires now on this car?
Yes. The Pennsylvania tires that were built, you know, made back out of, in Pennsylvania, and they've been on the car ever since.
What kind of reaction do you get from the general public when you're driving down the street?
They're amazed. They just stop. They pull me up, want me to pull over so they can take pictures of the car because they've never seen anything like it before.
How about being street legal? I don't see any headlights, and you've got straight pipes on it. Is that okay here, or is it okay on specific cars?
It's okay here. I mean, you know, the police, they enjoy the cars. I haven't had any problems with it yet, but there's always the possibility of getting pulled over. Mm-hmm. But, you know, you also do the hand signals, and that kind of helps with getting around. Uh-huh.
To build a car is so incredibly expensive these days, the way some people do it. There are still Buicks out there available, you know, sedans, coupes, whatever, from the 20s. Would you recommend somebody taking one of those cars and turning it into something like this?
Well, they could. I mean, you're going to destroy, you know, a beautiful old car, but it's doable if you got the time and the money to do it.
Paul, any chance of having you fire this up so we can hear it?
Sure, not a problem.
All right, let's do that. Paul, thank you very much. That is really fun.
Hey, you're welcome. Thank you.
All right, thank you.
Appreciate it.
If you think back in your memory bank about 2-3 years ago, I guess it's been, we had this fine gentleman, Ed Justice Jr., on the show. We were in his racing museum in Duarte, if I remember correctly.
Yeah. Duarte. Man, you even got the local accent. It's amazing. Duarte.
Duarte. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Ed Justice Jr., he is a real fixture in the automotive industry. His company makes a great product, lots of great products to keep your cars running. And we were standing here very happily doing an interview with somebody else, and behind me pulls this beautiful 38 Ford.
39. You know what? I'm gonna put a sign on the front because everybody gets it confused with a 38. And the reason why
the grill.
Yeah, from what I understand, I'm not a Ford expert, but I've had the guys tell me that supposedly are. The 38 Deluxe is the same as the 39 Standard. And so this is a standard coupe, standard businessman's coupe or business coupe, et cetera. And the reason why the 39 is really the car of choice of what this car represents and also moonshiners is because it was the first year of hydraulic brakes. And if you've ever driven a car with mechanical brakes, you know what that means.
Yeah, yeah. Henry finally came around.
And, right. Yeah. I mean, mechanical brakes will do enough to scare you. I mean, you hit the brake pedal and you start to figure out whether you're going to stop. With the mechanical, I mean, the hydraulic brakes on this car, in modern traffic, it's sort of like mechanicals were back then. So, anyway.
Is there any form of liquid that you would recommend to put into those hydraulic brake systems?
Well, yeah, we have a great brake fluid that we make.
What are the chances?
Yeah, well, you know, hey, if it's a liquid in the car or you need something to make it run better that comes in a can or a bottle, yeah, we make that. We make over 100 products now. You know, the company started a long, long time ago with my dad and my uncles, and they, you know, they were the first sponsors in NASCAR, and that's sort of why I did this car, because they sponsored this car, which this car represents the first NASCAR champion in 1948. And of course, these were the cars they also ran prior to the formation of NASCAR. I mean, stock car racing started before NASCAR was around. And everybody thinks Bill France came around and came up with this idea for stock car racing, and that's just not true. You know, I mean, stock car racing came out of the fact that you had all these moonshiners that were running these cars carrying 300 gallons of moonshine in a tank in the back of one of these, because the back end of this car is like a pickup truck with a body. And, you know, then they'd say, well, I think my car is faster than your car, and they'd go out to some farmer's yard and make a circle track, and that's how they'd find out who was the best. And then crowds would show up, and then somebody got the bright idea that you could charge for people to watch this. And after the war, Bill France saw the opportunity and formed NASCAR. And actually, the guy who coined the name NASCAR was a guy by the name of Red Vogt, who was the mechanic on the original this car. And he was, actually, my uncle dated his sister. And the story goes on and on.
I understand that you have the second best wife in the world. Mine's number one.
Yeah.
I understand that your wife gave you this as a birthday present.
Yeah. Yeah, she really did. She had me look at it to make sure that it was the right car, which was a smart thing. Because she admittedly doesn't know all the fine points of the cars, but she is as much of a car nut as I am, and it is a great thing. I mean, I bought a Celine Parnelli Mustang. It runs, yeah. You know. So anyway, I was a little bit hesitant. Parnelli's a very good friend of mine and all, but I go, God, honey, do we really need another car? Because, you know, in our museum, we got like 120 cars now. And she goes, I know you're going to buy that car. Why don't you just buy it? Well, okay, I got green-lighted on that deal. So I didn't have to, you know, buy it and sort of hide it for a few months like I know some of my friends do. And then they go, the wife finds the car, and she goes, hey, where'd that car come from? And then they use what your wife generally uses on you. Oh, that old car? I've had that for years.
So if there's a wife out there, maybe a particular wife, that wants to really prove her love for her husband, she should get him a car like this for his birthday, March 7th.
Oh, there you go. And what would your birthday happen to be?
March 7th. what are the chances?
Amazing. Amazing. Well, you know, does your wife watch your shows?
She's going to watch this one.
Yeah, all right.
I'm walking around the event today, and I hear this gentleman talking about an automobile that he has owned for 50 years. Bruce Carnahan, tell us about this beautiful 54 Jag.
Well, as I say, I bought it 50 years ago from a friend of mine who bought it brand new. And he bought it in November 1954. And they were going to have an addition to their family. They needed to get a sedan. So I've been looking at a Austin Healey or Triumph, and this was on the market, so I grabbed it right away and enjoyed it. Funny thing is, my wife and I took our first vacation in it, Easter vacation, because I was a school teacher, in 1958, and we're going up to British Columbia, and we're going through Oregon. I hear the horn honking like mad. We're actually coming south. And there's Russell, we bought the car from, going north in his Jag sedan. So it was unusual happenstance.
Owning the same car for 50 years, how come you haven't gotten tired of it?
Never get tired. This is part of the family. My wife says I take it out on Saturdays to go up to the car gathering for a spin, back it out of the garage, and I'm immediately 30 years younger. And I come home with a big smile on my face. And pat it, it's a member of the family.
I understand. A 54 Jaguar XK120. Where did the 120 fall in as far as the Jaguars that were available in 1954?
Okay, the first Jaguar XK120 was shown at the auto show in England in October 1948. And it was a new creation, and it set the world on its ear. All the press people were excited about it. Everybody wanted one. So they started production in July of 1949. The first 240 were all aluminum bodied. And then in about May of 1950, they were able to produce a car with a steel body, aluminum hood, aluminum doors, aluminum trunk, cheaper and quicker because the body was stamped out. So that was a changeover, and they produced it until the end of September 1954, and then they came out with the XK140 in October 1954. And I actually at one time had left-hand drive XK140 number 19. And it was sold in Hornburg Jaguar, same month that my friend bought this car, same dealer, and it was a new car. Mm-hmm. So anyway, I sold it many years ago.
How many restorations has this undergone?
Never been restored. It was repainted in 1968 and reupholstered for the third time, the seats, last year. And those are the original chrome wire wheels. The knockoffs were new about 20 years ago, and I only use a lead hammer on them now. And the red brake drums, that's the way my friend bought it from the dealer. And it's pastel blue. And I told Barry McGuire, touch the paint and feel how nice and smooth it is, your polish. And I said, but the paint underneath was done in 1968. He said, oh my goodness.
In 1957, that's when you bought this? That'd be 50 years ago?
Yeah, July or June 1957.
The car community, well, I would think in 1957, this type of car was owned by kind of the well-heeled tweed and pipe-smoking set. What kind of reaction did you get from the car community back then?
Well, not really. By that time, a lot of these cars had been raced. When the car came available in the late 40s, 49, 50, a lot of the owners of these cars were Hollywood personages. Clark Gable, as near as I can tell, had as many as five of them, and he always said it was his favorite car. And Humphrey Bogart had one, and Ray Milland had one. Cars were around, and they were raced very successfully in the early 50s, and so I think by that time, the time I got it, you ran into a lot of people. Sports car nuts rallied and vintage raced, well, not vintage, but actually raced them, and were quite active in driving the cars in sports car events. Mm-hmm. And so.
So all these years, you've got to be just like one of those movie stars in the past.
I don't think so. I was a high school teacher when I bought it.
A high school teacher with almost new Jag. That's great. Yeah. Bruce, thank you very much for being on the Vintage Vehicle Show. We appreciate it, and enjoy another 50 years in this car.
I plan on it.
We have had such a great time here at Autobooks in beautiful downtown Burbank. Great selection of books, a lot of great people here every Saturday morning, good cars, really a good time. We'd like to thank everybody we had a chance to talk to, and thank you for watching, and until next time, see you then. Bye-bye.